Welcome to Kia Ora New Zealand. Budget 2020 has been a landmark one, as well as the unprecedented circumstances that it was launched in. It is as unprecedented in some of its spending proposals. A budget that will ultimately lead the country to a debt of $200 billion or some $70,000 per household. What does all this mean? And what are the options for the government, business, and industry? Join me in a conversation with experienced corporate management and governance consultant, Jay Basroor. Jay's interests include economic value identification and realization, business model design, organizational structuring, and governance and leadership. He has advised public sector institutions and think tanks on free trade matters. Jay established his own corporate advisory consulting firm in Auckland in 2007, which provides strategy, corporate finance, and forensic accounting advisory services. His clients include listed and unlisted New Zealand and overseas organizations from diverse sectors. He is a New Zealand Trade and Enterprise Beachhead Advisor, where he advises growing New Zealand businesses. He has also advised World Bank on corporatization projects and has previously been partner with Ernst & Young, which is known as EY today. Hi, Jay, and welcome to Indian Weekender Kia Ora New Zealand. Glad to have you on the program, and we'd like to know from you your views about what you think of the budget, which was released last week under the most surreal of circumstances. We've never had things, situations like this before in New Zealand. So you as an expert and who's seen so many budgets before, what's your take on this one?
Thank you, Dave. Thanks for the opportunity and privilege to share some ideas with you. I think the last 8 weeks or the last 10 weeks have changed the entire canvas from an economic and a social perspective. And in fact, from a personal perspective, coming specifically to what's happened in New Zealand, I think what we've done is tremendous in terms of controlling the virus. Hopefully it's been eradicated. My brief today is to share some ideas from an economic perspective. And what we've seen, Dave, is quite unusual, because earlier we've had economic upsets. You know, if you look at the 1929 depression, it was really an economic event. And then later on, we did have various economic upheavals like the dot-com bubble in roughly 2001 and the GFC in 2008 as well. Those have been economic events. It's one of the first times that we've really had a social and an economic event come together. And what we've tried to do in this budget is we brought in a huge amount of public debt funding. I mean, the figures you can get from the web to fund a social issue and an economic issue. Now, this is great because fortunately, New Zealand had a huge amount of surplus capacity on its domestic, on its national balance sheet. Our GDP to debt ratios were such that we could afford to go up to the level. Which brings us into focus another aspect which is very relevant, and that is that economic models have changed, and we are still using, you know, traditional measures like GDP and GNP and so forth to measure economic growth, and that is effectively a stock measure where we look at how much has been generated over a period of time in terms of productive assets. But when you look at it, that measure itself is a little fraught because it doesn't recognize a lot of intangible aspects which are produced. For example, what has come into fore thanks to COVID and the lockup is a kind of output which is created by household units, like domestic services, like household services. Now, those can't be quantified in dollar terms, but the contribution to the economy is so huge. They're quite often intangible. For example, if the family units had not bonded together and effectively reflected or cooperated in terms of the responses to the levels of lockdown that we have, our story would have been quite different. So that contribution has been huge. And now once you do that and then talk about GDP on the other hand, you get a bit of a disparity because you don't pick up the whole story.
So that's is there a new yardstick called for?
Yes, I think what I'm encouraged by is moving away from a typical stock measure to a velocity or a flow measure. Because what will happen in future is not going to be only based upon value at a point in time, which is what we do. Like if you look at a stock value, we're looking at a stock measure. Or if you look at a balance sheet, we're looking at a stock measure. What is going to happen with technology through connections is going to be how do people connect? What are the cooperative clusters that we create? What is the cooperative output that we create? And how quickly do we create it? So it's going to become a flow measure rather than a stock measure. It's almost like a cash flow or what we get in terms of monetary terms as monetary measures, but taking it to a level where we are looking at other intangible factors as well. Because yes, dollars are important, but what has become very important, particularly with the confluence of social and economic policy, is that we should be looking at various other measures as well. Because economic consequences happen when people's health is good, their education is good. And to that extent, I think the living standards framework which the government promulgated in the last budget is a very useful paradigm to go with. It's a good framework to look at where you allocate resources. But we have to now blend those two. So what we have to do is to blend our social thinking, which is represented by the living standard framework, and our economic setting. I hope that explains, because that is a big change, because earlier the budget used to be really a question of looking at how the government funds various programs, various initiatives. But now we have to look at the social aspect as well. And in New Zealand, this is even more pronounced because we do have a social policy net in terms of benefits that we provide. And now, of course, we are talking about universal basic income. That's also being talked about. Health is another state a priority. Now, that doesn't happen in a lot of places, but in our case, it does. Add to that, we got another layer coming in, and that is the government participation in creating an employment policy net through subsidized value schemes, subsidized wage schemes, through wage subsidies, and so forth. So what we have now is a very interesting confluence. The government used to first set organizational arrangements or institutional arrangements or laws or broad frameworks within which a free market used to operate. But now, through participation in this subsidy, it's become a participant in this market mechanism. And that has not happened before. Having said that, this is a change. And I firmly believe that any system has a certain point at which it changes context. I'll take you one of the examples that I have been looking at, which I think has some relevance here, is what happened in post-war Germany, which had been very badly decimated, and the Marshall Plan came into being. And thanks to the work of the Freiburg School of Economics, they developed this concept called as a market social policy, where the government became a live participant in markets, but it enabled free market economics to operate. For example, private property was allowed to operate, businesses were allowed to operate. But what the government did was it created frameworks where it encouraged businesses to get together. It helps businesses to merge. So it was a live participant, but it created a latitude for private property to operate. And I think that sort of a model would be quite useful now, because effectively the government has become a market participant.
Absolutely.
I think now the government now has a role to actually catalyze economic confidence, which brings me to the next point about the implications of the budget. Now, what we have done is a huge amount of money is being pushed into the economy. But what we have to do now is to create a substantial amount of business confidence and consumer confidence. Investment is not only a factor of money being pumped in, but it's also the confidence that people have in the future. Ultimately, what people have to do is to say, look, I can either not do anything because I don't have confidence in the future, or I'm optimistic about the future, and then invest on that basis. Looking at what's happened to business consumer confidence, business confidence, we've had a huge decline. It was negative, but I think at about 12 or 13% earlier, but now it's at a negative 62%. Now that's a huge drop. Our job as in business and at a micro setting is to change that. Now we may not get it positive in terms of a vector change, but it's important that we get that direction changing. We have to move it from minus 62 to, even if you move it up to minus 30, minus 40, in terms of the right direction, it'll be a very good thing.
But isn't that all sentiment? And don't you think it'll come down drastically once the lockdowns are done away with?
I have a slightly different take on that, Dev. It's not only a question. Yes, that is one of the factors when people start moving about, etc. But the other point is this, that people start asking the question like, will the old model work? Will the old economy work? Like, for example, what has happened in the retail sector? You know, when I talk to some of my associates in the retail sector, they say the business is down 80-90%. Now, the way that they do business has changed. Most people have now got into the habit of ordering online, delivery is online, logistics are changed in model. Now, we are talking of different business models. What we need is leadership, which gives us the direction to adapt these new models in change environments. So we need somebody who says, all right, we're going to change the way we do business here. We are going to become an established service provider, but we are going to be providing services in a very different mode using digital technologies or interconnections or different worlds of getting a word across. This sort of a paradigm was not existing till virtually the middle of last year. But it has been changing, and that has been accelerated now. The other thing is that once you get that, we are talking of a new business model, and what will become paramount is that we have the right leadership who can lead us into it. Because you ask the question about won't that happen automatically? Yes, people will feel better once they start going out, but you need leadership and direction to make that sort of a transformation. And that is a big job. It doesn't happen overnight, but it has to start. And our big challenge is really going to be to get those visionary leaders and to get the nucleus of that change around which we can build those business clusters going forward.
Is that sort of leadership? Do you see that kind of leadership in the political milieu in New Zealand at the moment?
I see it in parts. And I think I see it in certain industries where innovation has taken place, but there are other people who are doing it. And many of these leaders who do it are not people who are big noters. You don't read about them in the press, but they get on and quietly create these clusters or create these models, create customer loyalty, adapt to it. And in fact, I'm quite encouraged by the value-based leadership model which Kramer talks about, where he talks about four or five qualities of leadership, which I think would become quite useful for us to go ahead. Because these are leaders who are not going to be based on positions. They're not going to be voted into power, but these are people who influence power by virtue of their values and by virtue of their vision. These are people who are more influencers, who influence people around them to make that change. And that's the kind of change I would like to see. Which also is another case for bringing in possibly a more cooperative approach to business. I know Prime Minister Ardern talked about kindness. And I think that value is equally important in business because if you look at the way competitive strategy has developed in the past, it's driven off almost a warlike mentality, saying that we need to win, which means that we need to take share or we need to grow at the cost of another. Now, I think we need to change our thinking on that because in this environment, we are possibly talking of more collaboration and cooperation going forward.
Right, but you know, kindness, as you just mentioned, and is absolutely right, you know, that kindness is the need of the hour. It's always been the need for humanity, but it's always been shortchanged because it hardly has any tangible effect on shareholder value. How do you measure that? How do you measure kindness?
Well, I think the way we measure it is through growth. It's a bit of a symbiotic relationship between a value and values. The value we've been measuring is shareholder value, which talks about creating a surplus relative to the cost of capital that you're using.
Right.
Okay, that's how you get your shareholder value. But if you change that narrative and start talking about a growth in customer connections, and if you talk about it in terms of scaling of IP, if you talk about it in terms of scaling the velocity at which you are getting innovation through on a cooperative basis, the economic consequences follow. They don't become the primary target. They become a consequence of a good strategy. And what has happened over a period of time, and this has been my experience, is that often measures get mixed up with strategy. Whereas I think a time has come where we need to change the sequence. We need to look at, firstly, our business model. Then we need to look at our leadership. Then we need to look at the kind of ways that we operate, like cooperation and so forth, and let the economic consequence come later on. The economic consequences will come, but it won't come only by denying or taking market share, but by growing the cake together. Which brings me to another area, Dave, and again, these are personal perspectives. There's been a lot of talk about getting a huge amount of funding, you know, which is expected to go up to $200 billion in 2024, if those numbers are to be believed. But I've not seen a lot of talk about growing the GDP, which is not a static target. I mean, our GDP has been circa 200 to 250 billion, about that order for a long time. But what I would like to see is to change the emphasis from just looking at the funding of it, which is going up, let's say, to 200 billion. We should be looking at how do we grow our GDP from 200 to 500 billion. You know, then once we get that growth, this ratio of debt to GDP doesn't become that important because we're growing it all the time. It doesn't matter where we get the funding. It's important that we get productive use out of it. Now, the participation of the government in the economy in many ways is a fiscal participation. You know, it is in infrastructure projects, it's in housing and so forth. But where I think business becomes relevant is to see how we create a productive economy on the asset side of the balance sheet, of the government balance sheet, where we grow the GDP beyond 200 billion. We need to grow it up and scale it up to 400, 500 billion. That I think is a challenge for business. And we can do it because with technology and the low level of capital requirements to fund technology and customer growth, there's no reason why we can't do it. And I think New Zealand is well placed because in addition to our commodity businesses like dairy and water-based economies or grass-based economies, we also have a lot of intangible assets and intellectual property which we could scale up, like medical technologies or agro-technologies.
So what we're saying is that we've run up this 200 billion debt, or rather we will end up running that kind of figure of debt. And we have no plan as yet of how we're going to service that. Is that what you're saying?
Well, it's been left to the business sector or the individual recipients of that funding to do it. Like the small business loan scheme, which has been put up, is a loan to businesses. But what I would like to say is, like to see more of, is that the government or the public sector or some institutions get involved in catalyzing that growth, which uses that funding. I don't think we can leave it to the existing business alone to handle it. The challenge is much bigger than that. And it's a national priority. It's not something that should be left to an individual to operate. It has to be done in the overall context of a national setting. That's what I'm saying.
All right. And what about New Zealand's traditional businesses, like you know, export, for example, which is going to suffer, as well as tourism, which is already suffering to such an extent. How do you see that coming back? Because that's absolutely vital if we have to grow the economy. Because that's really, those have been our drivers for so many years.
The tourism and travel will need funding. I mean, that will have to be subsidized.
But the $4 million, which has been earmarked, do you think it's enough, or probably there's more of hidden in that $20 billion pot, which has been kept aside right now?
Well, I think tourism is going to be badly affected, largely because you're not going to get tourists coming in. You know, there's going to be border restrictions for some time. Because from our major markets where people have been coming, like China and so forth, I don't see that changing in a while. The Australian market will possibly open up, looking at what's happening. But that will not be enough to get us the scale. What I think will happen, what I think needs to happen is two things. Firstly, I think the government funding will be helpful. Maybe we'll need more. But I think the second thing we need to do is to possibly look at encouraging some sort of aggregation in that industry. See, when you look at tourism and travel, there are a lot of small players. And I don't mean this disparagingly, but I mean people who don't have the balance sheets to withstand a shock. Whereas what would be useful is if we create mega companies in these sectors by bringing them together. And we create larger companies with more solid balance sheets where everybody sort of participates. For example, if you've got two or three travel operators, you know, offering similar service in Rotorua, Queenstown, maybe we can bring them together. Yes, there will be some pain because we might lose some jobs. But I think that will be better than the alternative of everybody suffering. I think the loss will be less. The other thing we could do is think about some sort of tax incentives for the sector, like maybe a tax holiday for a little time, which is sector based or which is region based. Because as I see it, Rotorua and Queenstown, which are tourist based economies, are likely to get affected. And I think we will have to subsidize that sector. It will come up because I think New Zealand Inc. is a much sought after brand. And it is a national asset. And reality is this, that in any economy, it's a portfolio. Not all sectors fire at the same time. If it does, it's great. It doesn't happen that way. So you do effectively have to subsidize one of the sectors. It so happens that at this time, we've got an issue with our tourism and our travel sector. And that is the world over. I think we'll have to subsidize it in some form and encourage some sort of aggregation, so we get some efficiencies. Maybe some tax breaks are necessary. And this brings into play another question. There is, I think, a public sentiment that the tax policy settings could change, should be changed. For example, we could think about changing GST on food. We are one of the few countries which does have indirect taxation on food. Now, what we're doing is providing wage subsidies on one hand, but we are taxing food as an indirect tax. Now, to me, that is regressive. What I would rather do is, if you're giving this sort of an incentive like a subsidy, why don't we think about reducing our GST from 15% to maybe 5%? Send out the signal that we want to encourage consumption. Let that happen. And the net effect of that might be positive, because if consumption goes up in terms of volume, you might find a greater amount of tax take rather than people not spending because of the tax being at 15%, which they just have to absorb. If you look at an average family unit now, after they've paid, let's say that they're in a rental unit, once they pay for rent, they hardly have money for food.
Yes.
Look at the amount of people going into food centers, etc. If we can do something on those two sectors, which are the basic needs, I think that would be very helpful.
Thank you very much, Jay. We could have gone on like this for much longer, but it'll be good to have you on the show on other specific topics later on.
Thank you, Dave, and thank you for the privilege. I'm deeply honored.